So we're here in Thessaloniki, and hi.
Hello, welcome to the LTFN lab. I am Stelios, I am a biologist. Here is a multidisciplinary lab, and we will start your tour from vacuum technologies.
Nice. So you have your colleague right here?
Yes, this is Trifonas.
Hello.
Hi.
He's a physicist.
Cool. So what do you have here?
We have here an ultra-high vacuum chamber, in particular an e-beam evaporator chamber. If you want to see the machine inside.
What can I see there and there?
Here we can see the gate of the pump, who
makes the vacuum in there?
Yeah, yes, which makes the vacuum. And also here we have the sources where an e-beam evaporator is focused on these sources, and the material is evaporated and is deposited on the substrates inside the vacuum.
So what's the purpose of doing this kind of stuff, the thin film and everything?
So here there is a vacuum technology that we can remove all air molecules so that they will not interact with other molecules that we want to spin around. And we can modify a surface of a substrate. We can add some molecules there in a very defined way. And we can also apply some masks and start building some kind of device, some kind of electrical device, by alternating the different layers that we add.
So how do you do that?
In particular, we deposit metal layers, like silver or gold.
And how do you put them in? How does it work?
How does it work?
Do you have to put your hand in there? Or
Here we put the sources.
So this, you put the sources
here,
coming in?
The sources, which are in this, which are here, if you can see. Here we have the sources, the crucibles. And here we adjust the voltage and the current to create the beam, the electronic beam, which is focused in these sources, and the material is evaporated and is deposited on the substrate. In and particular, the metallic pellets, gold pellets or silver pellets.
And what do you do in there with these?
And here we put the sample in this chamber, this first leaf in this chamber, and then we open the gate that isolates the two chambers, and we pass the sample in this ultra-high vacuum chamber.
So we're here in Thessaloniki, and do you have some special competences? You are like really good at making a lot of cool things in this field?
Yeah, the really cool thing about this technology is that it's not only one of the few around the world, but also we combine it with real-time metrology. So we can measure at the same time that everything is deposited onto a substrate, we can measure the changes of the properties of the film that is created. So this is something very unique.
So
and this is applicable also to when we go to larger scale production.
And is this also another machine here? How does it combine? What does this one do? What does this one do? Is just a totally different machine right here, right?
It's not totally different. It's something similar. So main piece of equipment is this one that we described
nice.
Now.
But on this tour, we're going to be checking out a whole bunch of stuff, right?
Yes.
So should we go in another room and check some more?
Yes.
Some other
yes,
things?
We can. So you can follow us.
All right. So where are we right now, actually?
We are in Aristotle University, physics department. And we are visiting the different rooms of LTFN lab.
This is a nuclear particle physics,
yeah.
Right?
Does not belong to our lab.
Danger, radiation. Okay, it's just your neighbors.
I hope they are isolated.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you can.
All right, we enter here. Hi.
Hello.
Hello. Who are you?
My name is Alexandros. I'm a student on a master in nanotechnology and nanoscience.
What's happening right here in the computer?
Now we are slicing a model for a 3D bioprinter to convert it in a readable document for a printer.
It's a, like a bioprinter, it's a special kind of printer, right?
Yes. Cool. As the procedure is the same for all kinds of printers.
Nice, we're going to check that just after. So where are we right now, this room here?
We are where we produce our nanoparticles and nanofibers.
So this is a biology?
This is a group that deals with a lot of things, with printed electronics, organic electronics, photovoltaics, but also a lot of coatings and things around biomedicine and nanobiomedicine. So one of the main focuses of the lab is nanotechnology. We go down to nano as a production, fabrication, but also characterization of nanostructures. And here you can see a device that is called electrospinning or electrospraying. As you can see, there is a needle there.
It's not a 3D printer.
It produces some kind of 3D structures, but at the nano level. So depends on how you judge 3D objects.
So what do you? How does it work? What does it do?
Yeah. So in that syringe over there, you put inside a polymer solution, and let me move the needle so that you can see. Yeah, it goes down as you can see. Yeah. And when it is in position, we apply a big voltage difference between the metallic needle and the metallic stage. So this accelerates the polymer that's inside, and as it evaporates, it creates nanoparticles or nanofibers depending on the parameters that we have already set. By this way, we create nanofibers and nanoparticles that can have encapsulated any type of drug, active substance.
So it could be for like the medicine field.
Exactly. It could be a coating on a contact lens. It could be a coating on a bone screw used for orthopedic surgery. It could be wherever you want a very controllable release of some kind of active substance. Because the encapsulated active substance inside the nanofibers or the nanoparticles has a controlled release rhythm.
So how does a vacuum machine and this interface, are they compatible or is totally different?
First of all, they are all at the nano level. They produce all some nano surfaces, nano coatings. Here we produce nanofibers, nanoparticles. So the specialty of the lab is whatever comes around nano, nano fabrication or nano characterization.
Nice. And we can check some of this stuff over here also?
So we can also go now to the nano characterization.
Nice.
Because it's not enough to know that you build something, but you have to know exactly what the properties are.
All right. Hi. So,
hi.
Hello.
Hello.
So
hello.
Who are you?
Let me show you nanoparticles that Stelios develops in the electrospinning. You can see here the scaffold. This is the scaffold.
So
this is an AFM image, atomic force microscope image, where we can see the scaffold that Stelios develops. You can see the scaffold here with it's a 3D image.
Of the atoms? Is it with this machine?
It's nanofibers. It's the what Stelios developed in the electrospinning. It's nanofibers with nanoparticles. And you can see here the net of the nanofibers. You see?
Is this with this machine?
Yeah. This is an also awesome machine called AFM, Atomic Force Microscope. It has a cantilever that interacts with atoms, and it can measure some very small distances.
You can depict the nano materials. You can show an image of the nanomaterials. How the
what he's showing is actually atoms, or what is this?
Nanofibers and drugs, nanoparticles.
And how does it work, this machine? So what's happening there?
There is a cantilever, a very tiny cantilever. In nanometers, who scans the surface, and with the scanning, and the laser reads this movement, and in this way you can depict the surface of the substance. You can see here the laser, and this is the spot And this is the spot of the laser. You can see it here on the photocathode.
So how does it connect? Can you transition like from the vacuum to this to this? Yes. What's the story here?
Still, you cannot see the connection. We will connect everything soon. But up to now, you have seen how we produce the nanoparticles and nanofibers, and here how we visualize them, how we measure the height, how we measure the roughness, how we analyze what we have produced. Now, Trifonas.
It's a camera with very high resolution, or very low size.
It's a very special microscope that goes down to nanometers.
It's like, do you remember the turntable?
Yeah.
Where you have this pin that reads the music. So in this way, we use a pin, a very tiny pin in nanometers, with which we can read the nano material, the materials in nanoscale.
The topography of the surface.
Cool.
Okay. So now, we also showed you at the beginning of the video the vacuum technologies. There, we can also develop some kind of devices, electrical devices, that can be used for sensors. And also, we need to characterize their performance. So here, Trifonas will show you a machine that can characterize all the electrical performance of the devices that we are trying to build.
What is this machine? What do you call it?
This is an electrical characterization machine. It's a KEITHLEY machine, and we can characterize the devices, the organic electronic devices, such as organic photovoltaics, organic transistor devices, and here we have a flexible device. All the devices are fabricated on the flexible PET foil,
those are flexible.
Yes, flexible
transistors or what?
Flexible transistor devices. And we fabricate these devices with printing technologies such as low dye method, inkjet printing for the electrodes of the transistors. And now we'll put these devices to the proper station, and we can put here. We put the flexible devices, and we can put with these probers, and we put these probers to the electrode of the devices to make a contact and to measure. You wish to take some photos from here, but I don't know if you can take it.
So, in there?
Yes.
So, what does it see?
Here we have a transistor channel devices. We can see the source and drain device, the contacts.
Yeah.
And here we can see the transistor channel. It's a single transistor, and the orange color is the organic semiconductor of the device.
How do you produce these organic flexible transistors? Is it like standard technology in the industry, or you making something special with this, or you're researching what's the best way to do it?
There are some innovations depending on the characterization, how we can see in real time what we are producing here, and also the ability to make everything printable. Printable means very cheap. They can be scaled up, they can be flexible.
It can be a rolling machine?
Roll to roll, yeah.
Potentially this is billions of devices printed very cheaply.
Yeah, very cheaply.
And this is happening, right?
Very fast.
This is happening in a large scale here, and we can upscale in another facility.
Nice, that's cool. And you have even more stuff, right?
Yeah. So we can go to more biological stuff now.
Cool. Go on here. So what's your background?
I am a biologist. My PhD is on a mechanical engineering department on biomechanics. So from my PhD, I saw that we have to combine many disciplines in order to achieve greater things. Because I saw that, studying a static cell culture is not enough. You have to go dynamic.
So you did biology, but you want to go into the electronics from the biology?
Not yet, but this is what we are trying to do.
Nice.
We are trying to combine some
living computers.
Living computers, something like that.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Ooh.
So, this is our cell culture room.
You want to sit here?
Yeah, of course. And we also have a bioprinter. So, we saw how we produce some scaffolds and some drug delivery systems in the nanoscale. That is the nanoparticles and nanofibers. They can also be used as a part of a 3D complex construct that mimics somehow the native tissues. And in order to do that, we need to build this structure with a 3D printer, which is called bioprinter.
So this is BioX.
This is BioX, yeah. This is our 3D bioprinter.
Cool.
Now it is set up to bioprint a model of a nose.
Oh.
Yeah. It means that we have to combine some special biomaterials that mimic the native tissue and some cells together. So now by starting the bioprinting process.
It's going to take a while to print a nose, no?
It's going to take around 5 minutes. Of course, it's just a model of the nose. We are still far from the desired results, I mean worldwide, but this is a very powerful research tool. So we have the 3D model of the nose. We sliced it. This means that we created a language that the printer can understand. And now the printer deposits material wherever we dictate it to.
So in the future, potentially, you could print organs.
Yes, organs. Yeah,
yeah. Of organs.
Course. Yeah. This is the ultimate goal.
And or print, what could you potentially print, like medicine?
Sorry?
Potentially, you could print.
Potentially, you can replace an organ. You can take some. The ultimate goal, the ideal outcome, would be to take some cells from the patient. So you have personalized medicine here. You don't have some problems with immune systems. You cultivate the cells, you take the appropriate biomaterials, you mix them all together, you design the exact volume, the exact shape that you want to bioprint based on a 3D imaging technique like CT scan, like MRI, or whatever. And then along with some growth factors, some biological cues that dictate what the cells you want to do, you bioprint this construct.
Nice.
So,
what is this?
This is just a basic cell culture equipment. This is a laminar flow where we work under aseptic conditions. This is the incubator where we cultivate cells. This is a microscope. Right now, we see an image of what we earlier created. This is a network of non-woven nanofibers. So these nanofibers could be used as a scaffold for cells to grow on. They could be used as a barrier for cells not to penetrate, or they can be used as a drug delivery system. This means that they can very controllable release the active substance. So when you build some kind of organ, you can embed there some information on the fate of the cells, what the cells you want to do.
Nice. What is this, some papers?
Yeah, there are some papers from our lab, past papers, 2018, on bioprinting, scaffold producing techniques and characterization.
Scaffold producing techniques. So what is a scaffold fabrication in this?
A scaffold, as I mentioned earlier, is all this this mesh of nanofibers that can be used as a scaffold for cells. Cells will attach on there.
Nice. So you can spray them on or something in a specific way?
Exactly.
And then they have all different...
Yeah, you can tailor the properties of this scaffold to mimic a specific part of a tissue.
Nice.
So what we also want to do is not only stay on separately biological things or electronic devices, we want to combine everything. So we want to make tiny devices that can measure pressure, that can measure some biological activity, that can quantify some biological molecules. They are called biosensors. And we want to embed them into these biological systems, these tissues, to get some insight for the activity of the 3D printed tissue.
Nice. Yeah. And we just take the statues on the nose right here. It's going to take another little while to finish the nose.
Yeah, yeah.
So what else do you have in this room here? You have some other stuff over there?
Yeah, of course. As I mentioned earlier, we have some potential, many potential, to characterize what we have done. This is an ellipsometer. You can emit a kind of light. You have a reflection on the surface that you want to measure, and you have the detection here. So from the changes in the properties of light, you can understand many characteristics of the surface modifications that you achieved, like the depth, the many parameters of what you have created, what surface modification you have created.
Nice.
This is a similar device that works with X-rays.
So in there, it also measures the surface.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And also this is a nano indenter, because you want to measure the mechanical properties of the surface that you have created. No matter if it is a scaffold or if it is a thin film deposited with vacuum technologies, you want to measure also mechanical properties. Mechanical properties are very important for cells. When they have a stiff substrate, they will behave very in a very different way compared to when they are grown on a very soft material. So if you want to tailor to guide the cell's behavior, you need also to know the mechanical properties of your extracellular matrix, the materials that you make, or your substrate.
Nice.
And all that in combination also lead to very interesting applications, like systems on a chip, where you can build a whole system with microfluidics, with sensors, with a compartmentalization of basic organ unit in a single glass slide, and you can observe there the let's say, the potentials of a new drug. Also in a very personalized way, because it's possible to have cells from a specific patient while you build that. So it's a very effective way to screen the efficacy of a combination of drugs or a new drug substance.
But so all these awesome things you're showing around here, and what you're just talking about right here, how far is it in the future?
Yeah, we're still in research level for some things, let's say systems on a chip, organs on a chip, organ replacement, but for some things we are very close. Let's say biosensors are very close to happen.
Biosensors, what kind of?
As we said, we can have an electrical device miniaturized in size, and we can biofunctionalize it against some biomolecules. So we can detect specific concentrations of these biomolecules in, let's say, blood. So we can detect some cancer markers, we can detect some any kind of markers that circulate around our blood, depending on the molecules that we have chosen to biofunctionalize the biosensor. Also, we want to make this a smart system for reading some biomarkers. So we want to make it a very fast and very responsive system. And this is not far.
Nice. So at the trade show, there's a lot of flexible photovoltaics being shown. So that's actually happening?
Yeah, this is happening, yeah. This is also a product that can be used. This is happening. And it's not only for research purposes, it's also, it could be a product.
It also depends on the material, the price, the manufacturer, the cost of manufacturing.
It depends on many things, yes. Also, it depends on the application.
Efficiency?
Efficiency is very high for printed organic electronics. I'm not the expert to talk about that, but also depends on the applications, and there are many applications, like, let's say, make wearables that you can charge your smart devices, make some photovoltaics for greenhouses, cover some energy needs for houses, the or automotive industry. The potential is huge.
And if you can explain again the specific advantage you have here in Thessaloniki, are you have some specific combination of you're able to do something nobody else does, or?
Yes, the advantage we have here in this lab is that we have all this ecosystem of combination of different expertise, like thin film coatings, electronics, bioelectronics, scaffold producing technologies for bio applications, 3D bioprinting, metrology, nanometrology, and we can mix all that together in order to make a fantastic outcome.
And the potential is that if you get the right partners, the right customers, the right potential investments, or what can happen?
We have a lot of projects. We collaborate with many entities in Europe and in Greece that are companies, small companies, industry, other universities, and we work on many different projects, like agricultural processes for greenhouses, biosensors, nanocosmetics. Whatever you want, something that goes to the scale of nano, we can make it.
Nice. And here's the nose. The nose needs a little bit more to finalize.
Yeah.
All right, that's cool.
Yeah.
So thanks a lot. And in a few hours, it'll be the second day of the Nanotechnology Conference. 2019, a lot of things happening. Do you have presentations there also?
Yeah, a lot of presentations, poster sessions, expo. There are several events that run in parallel. One is on nanosciences and nanotechnologies. The other is on flexible organic electronics. The third one is on 3D printing, and that includes 3D bioprinting. There is also a school that's happening, and also other matchmaking events, other events that have to do with collaborations with some projects, and all that happens here in Thessaloniki.
And hundreds of people coming from all over the world, right?
It's around 800 people, I think, latest statistics, 800 people from 60 countries around the world.
Cool.